Or are both teams going to be afraid to lose? Both sides of the coin are possible, but we're in champ select.
Yes, we are. You cannot be afraid to lose. You have to go for the win. H2K start off by banning the Victor. It's answered from Gambit Gaming with a Maokai and an Azir ban to turn it back. They're really focusing on Betsy this game.
Yeah, Ryu casually leaning back in his chair there. They're banning out. They're shooting himself in the foot. He's losing his mid laners. Might prompt an early mid lane champion pickup if you're already targeting Betsy at the same time. Betsy usually doesn't get too much share in Gambit's farm pool. The later parts go mostly to Forgiven. A lot of it went to Cabochard. So Betsy doesn't get much resources to work with within the Gambit lineup. And on top of that, gets target banned as well. And then the last ban here, Lucian coming out, typical target ban into Forgiven. Forgiven gets rid of the Sivir himself. Champion he doesn't fancy playing all too much. We saw him speak highly of Ashe, said it was a fun champion in the feature we saw on the Queen of Failure earlier. Maybe.
We'll get to see it. Who knows? I mean, Gambit are taking their time about this ban, though. This last one that they've got. But go back to Betsy for a minute. I think he's going to be in a little bit of trouble because not only are the two champions he's played already banned out, yes, he also has a very, very low kill share on his team. He doesn't really get involved as much as some of the other ones. He's actually ranked 8th among mid laners for as much damage he does as a part of his team. I mean, part of that you have to attribute to Forgiven being on the squad, but still, Ryze is now banned away. They just don't want to deal with it. Vice versa, Odoamne is actually the top laner who does the most damage.
Now, what is H2K gonna do? Are they gonna first pick a mid laner? They don't have to, because they can leave it for the middle rotation and put the pressure on Betsy. That way, if they take away one of his champions, either if he feels uncomfortable with this little champions, he might actually pick early in the Gambit draft, reveal his mid laner, give Ryu the counter pick, even though Gambit has the purple side. Usually fifth pick is counter pick mid lane in most of the games, but due to the way this ban phase played out, Betsy might actually be forced to take an early pick. That's a bit of a hover. And Thresh, opening Thresh with Alistar open?
Yeah, there's a lot H2K? Open here too.
Hello?
All the junglers too haven't been banned. I mean, there's a lot that left on the board. Gambit, you know, Diamond Prox had a few interesting jungle choices last week. I think he's going to go a little bit more standard this time around. Not surprised at all to see the Gragas if they do lock it in. And Caitlyn, we may or may not see that. That was what Forgiven would default back to when his favorite champions were banned away or taken. But they don't have to pick this first.
Yeah, I want to reiterate on that part where Lucian banned. You used to ban Lucian and Graves, but Graves has fallen so far out of the metagame that he's basically banned without even entering champ select. And then Lucian rid of it. And as you said, he used to resort to Caitlyn a lot. He's not afraid to pick it early because he played into anything with a similar style. Gragas, slight nerf on him, but still there. And I believe Lulex actually used to favor Rek'Sai over Gragas anyway, so I don't think H2K will be mad about the way this draft went down. Betsy going for Lulu, he has played that in the past. Passive mid laner, utility focused, and if you look at the way Gambit plays and the way teams with Forgiven played, I think that's quite all right. Betsy adding utility to the two carries in his team, double threat coming out of Cabochard and Forgiven rather, and just taking a bit of a back foot. I like it. I think it's a decent pickup here for Gambit.
Mm-hmm.
But as we said, he reveals early. Unless it's a top lane Lulu, he already reveals his pick, even though he's on purple side.
Yeah, a little curious there. We'll have to see what H2K end up answering with for themselves. I mean, now they can still go for that. Let's pick first blind on the mid lane because we've narrowed the pool so hard. Is that what they do? Not sure yet. Lulex has favored the Rek'Sai a little bit. If they take that in Kalista, they do.
I like it. Pedal to the metal. Telling Forgiven, hey, if you want to lane 2v2, we'll take you. Kalista Thresh coming out of H2K. Thresh makes up for a lot of the weaknesses in Kalista. If she gets targeted or locked down, the Lantern comes out to save you, and you can even put the Lantern down first, then use Fate's Call, the tether will not break, throw Thresh backwards, and then you can immediately click the Lantern and chase your own ultimate. A little bit of a neat trick there on the Kalista Thresh lane. And Forgiven, is he gonna take the fight? Caitlyn does outrange Kalista pretty hard, but the Ashe coming in, just like he said in the feature.
Yep. Seems he was telling the truth there, Crepo. He does like the Ashe. They'll also go ahead and lock in a Fizz for Betsy.
Arguable flex. Fizz top works. Lulu top works. Fizz mid works.
We've even seen a jungle, but there's a Gragas, so forget it.
Yeah. Who knows? Teams might be switching it all up. I expect the Fizz to be top, and I expect the Lulu to be mid. But expectations have proven to be wrong before.
Mm-hmm.
Time for H2K to give their final answer. get the fourth and fifth pick in there. Ryo will have to reveal his cards. Find something that could potentially work against both Fizz and Lulu. Still has the potential to counterpick or make a guess.
Yeah.
Playing.
Well, you know, look who fell through the ban phase, too, and has fallen all the way to this rotation. I mean, LeBlanc, kind of something that we just took for granted was going to be banned coming into this week.
Yep.
Not the case this game. Would not be surprised to see Ryo pick that one up. A Rumble, also a very strong top pick. H2K can just go very basic, very general choices and be completely fine, trusting their mechanics and their teamwork.
Great point there, Pyra, actually, because LeBlanc totally forgot about it. Should have seen it coming in the draft since Victor's out, Azir's out. If Cassiopeia isn't prioritized too much due to the immobility, then LeBlanc's up, and then Lulu is a good pick into LeBlanc. We saw a lot of teams ban out Lulu, aiming for LeBlanc first pick, prompting the other teams to then counter ban LeBlanc in return, and that's why we saw such a high ban rate on her. And so far, good draft from Gambit. Even though H2K targeted mid lanes, they gave Betsy a pick that he can deal, or in theory, deal with a LeBlanc in the mid lane.
Oh! Okay, so this changes things up a little bit. We already saw Diamond Prox on a Volibear, and that means...
I lied.
Wait a minute. So
I've got the puzzle figured out.
Go ahead, go.
It's a loose.
I'm not touching Da Vinci Code.
Yeah, back to the old days. Or Gragas support. Okay, my puzzle was wrong. I was going to say the blue went to support. Well, in LCS, it takes until 20 seconds on the timer, and then we'll fill in the puzzle. Ghost with Pepper. Formerly known as Edward, used to play Gragas support back in the day. I've never liked it. I think it's too binary. And yes, I was right with my puzzle. I was gonna say I don't like the Gragas support at all whatsoever, because I think Lulu will do even better. Even though I'm not a fan of Lulu support, would have still liked to see Lulu play mid, but then again, the remaining support would be Fizz, and I guess with the options that they picked,
yeah,
it's quite all right.
Betsy
on Fizz.
They have thrown a pretty massive curveball H2K's way. Betsy on Fizz is the most normal thing, but you know, enough about that. Before we hit the rift, we're going to go ahead and take a closer look at this matchup that is sure to be a crazy one.
On paper, their roster is actually quite strong. Like, you have Forgiven, you have Cabochard.
After first week, my goals didn't change at all. So I just want to be the best.
If they don't fix their communication, it won't be surprising for them to pretty much get stomped.
We had this little to no practice at all. We'll see. Time will tell.
다음에 갬빗 있을 만나면 저희가 실수하지 않는 한 그냥 이길 것 같아요.
If we don't make any mistakes, we'll win. Well, if there's ever a way to win a game, it's by not making too many mistakes. But Ryu, do not overanalyze that quote. He is confident.
Clearly. And you'll need it to play into this Gambit squad that will be doing something very different this time around. We haven't seen Gragas in the top lane.
Quite a while.
Quite a while.
I feel like Gambit was well on the way with a fantastic draft or a decent draft, but then kind of decided not to.
You know, Cabochard actually did play Gragas top at least once in the spring split.
No,
but
he played it though.
Don't believe they won him.
Played it, or he can play it. I've seen him play it many times in solo queue. So that's not an issue. But I'd have liked to see. I mean, why? Why put the Gragas top lane when you can put it in jungle? When you have arguably the tier 1 jungler in your possession, why would you send it top lane to just play Volibear when there's barely any top lane champions banned? Boggles my mind a bit. Why put Betsy, one of the players that has stylistically a utility-based role within the Gambit lineup, doesn't get too many resources, doesn't get too much help on a hard carry, scaling carry like Fizz, and then move to Lulu support? Which is okay for Peel. Yes, it's double poke on that bot lane, but gets all in really easily. And I think H2K is not sure whether they should expect a swap on the bot lane or whether Forgiven's going to take the matchup anyways.
Mm-hmm.
Forgiven, extremely confident player, will play any matchup almost. Rarely see him initiate a lane swap. Aggressive invade from H2K, so they'll just take the swap and start at the enemy side of the map.
Absolutely. So. Gambit stacking fairly decent down on the bottom, but Diamond Prox in the enemy jungle while the rest of H2K are in his jungle. Some interesting things to note while we start this game off. Take a look down on the bot side, or what will be the bot side. Ghost Pepper, it's not that we haven't seen as much recently. That Ancient Coin, it did receive some buffs on this patch. Gives a little bit more gold. Nice and lucky. We'll see if that helps out Ghost Pepper this time around, but back to the game. You and Betsy.
In the lane swap, though, he'll have to stay in lane if he wants that passive gold from the coin. Betsy aggressive here with a little hopsky doodle. You're not too fazed. There's a Doran's ring there. Betsy sitting on a flask, so generally in flask matchups you want to stay 1v1 for the longest time because then you can slowly sustain and out-sustain your opponent. You have less damage but more regeneration. In the lane swap that tends to happen a lot more, barring some support roams. Look at the lanes. Bot lane definitely did not freeze as the camp was done by Ashe and Lulu. I think top lane did a camp as well. Yeah, those golems are gone, so no freeze either. So both lanes going on in a predictable pattern. And Gambit reacting to that with sending three people to the top lane. They might be expecting the what become quite standard four-man top lane push. And they leave Forgiven on his own, getting all the farm, uncontested.
So King XP as well, because Singh now is looking to roam down. Betsy is at half his health, so Kabishar, Ghost, Pepper, Diamond Prox, they've all arrived up in the top. But Yharnam isn't too worried about this. He's going to have to give up his dreams of pushing the wave at the moment, or pushing into the tower at the moment. Or maybe not. He's totally fine. There's a couple of spears.
Yeah, yeah. They're soaking up this XP, so they're stopping the 4v0. It's good for Gambit to pick up a lot of XP. In return, though, Oduwana recognizes this. He can base and look. Forgiven, he doesn't care.
Nah.
Slowly pushing out that lane. He says, I'm going to stack this wave as big as you want, and you can see it coming from a mile away. We, as Gambit, don't care about you getting all this XP. And this is creating an XP discrepancy. Forgiven will be ahead in solo lane XP of Yharnam. And Yharnam had to share, Forgiven had not. But at the other side of the coin, Oduwana just picked up two or three waves, whereas Kabishar, generally a solo carry on the Gambit side, lost a lot of experience. He had to soak and share with his team members.
So the question becomes here now, for H2K, are they okay with that? What is their plan going forward here? Because this has been sort of a weird start to this game. Both teams are trying to mind game each other, and they end up just mind gaming themselves.
Looking at Kalista here, Snowball AD carry, so it's quite good for Gambit's side that she's kept down a little bit, doesn't get too much impact. But on the other side, you don't really want to feed a Rumble either. 16 CS on Rumble, 13 on Gragas, relatively even in CS, but I think the tail of this game will be experience. In lane swaps, often a stat mistracked. People tend to tunnel vision on gold, on objectives, but miss out on what opportunity cost it brings, and that often is experience, especially on members like support. Ghost of Pepper, level 2. Pushing it to Kasing, possibly.
Mm-hmm. Nice to put that ward down. No sense of pace checking.
Yeah, and they're leaving Kalista alone in the top lane, and they want to slow down Forgiven's farm here.
Diamond Prox. He's got that flip, but they just don't really have that much damage. Diamond's playing a dangerous game here, but now Ghost of Pepper's caught out.
Has to flash. Right. Forgiven has pushed the wave into the bottom at the moment right now. So nobody picking up that experience. Again, it's an experience game in a lane swap. Denied 4, 5, 6 creeps on Oduwamni in trade for Ghost of Pepper's flash. So you're not trading objectives here, but you're trading cooldown, summoners, time spent. Everybody has to manage their resources pretty well. Very dynamic game, and it usually shows which teams are slightly better than their opponents.
Yep, this is the situation.
Here's Lulex.
That prove that or not. Forgiven immediately uses his heal. He's burning now, forced to flash away. Ghost of Pepper is there, and the teleport.
It got canceled on the top lane, so they're fighting in the top lane as well.
So Lulex, it stays a 2v2, and that's secured there, but it's a different kind of 2v2.
Yeah, that is vital, because if you gank your top laner, you have the risk of getting teleported upon, but Itsuke was ready for that, and they canceled the teleport. Big. Really, really big.
Yeah, that could have been a lot worse for H2K right now. So, as it is, Forgiven has requested the aid of his support. He's got no summoners, though, on himself right now. So if they decide to hit it hard, they might be able to do it. Forgiven now, focus down. Ghost of Pepper trying to help, but Forgiven's burning, and he gives up first blood. That one goes over to Oduwamne. Ghost of Pepper down, too.
Double kill on Oduwamne, and this is why I think Ashe is a good pick, but she has very innate weaknesses in her mobility. Non-mobile champion, once her summoner is down, she can get gap closed down, apparently even straight through the lane.
You're absolutely right.
That was a pretty telegraphed play. Lulex recognizing, okay, there's no summoners on Forgiven. They don't have insane damage because they're Lulu Ashe. They're a very poke-centered lane. Oduwamne has a whole heap of damage. Lands the Electro Harpoon. Pepper wasn't able to block that for Forgiven. And once he's knocked up and slowed, there is no escaping the Flamespitter. And 2-0 on Oduwamne, picked up the farm early, picked up the experience early. He's ready to become the top lane carry that H2K needs in this game.
Nice chains there for Ryu. Diamond Prox, on the other hand, so He showed a little bit of face in the mid lane. He's been roving around. He started on the opposite side jungle, but what has he really gotten done compared to Lulex this game? I guess the answer is maybe Dragon. That's what they're going to go ahead and start off. Lulex is there, though, on the prowl. They're still pinging for Forgiven as Gambit tries to sneak this.
Why did you swap the Volibear in if you had a Gragas? I still don't know. Maybe somebody knows, but my opinion, overzealous. Start the Dragon, get half HP. Diamond back into his jungle. No offensive pressure. He ganked mid lane once on Ryu, who has a gap closer, won that trade as well. Diamond looking like a bit of a shade of his former self here. Maybe had success with Volibear in scrims. We obviously never know, but so far, this showing and last week's, I am not impressed by the pick. And he had his hands on Gragas, and I'm not seeing it, but I might be missing something.
He's letting it slip through his fingers just because he hasn't really favored these two Volibear picks. It's leaving us scratching our heads. Diamond procs in this opener on week two here, or in this game on week two. He just hasn't gotten quite as much done. We'll see if that changes, but still troubling for Gambit Gaming.
Yeah, Kasing and Lulex hovering in the river, putting some pressure on both mid lane. Betsy goes in a bit too deep, has to go left. Probably make his way out, but we saw whenever Lulex and Kasing hover out of sight, Hoke just misses very barely, so I can continue my point. Forgiven and Edward have to play passively. Whenever Lulek has the threat of closing in that, into that lane on the bot lane, they have to back off and let Rumble farm, so good pressure there. Didn't really translate into anything. But H2K is controlling his game, and it's always showing in the gold, Pyra.
Yeah, and I feel like this is the game that they like to play. They want to get to a point where they are just casually able to grab objectives. They're casually able to make Gambit dance to their tune. And yeah, gold lead for them right now. Getting close to about 2,000 ahead. It's really only off the back of those two kills and farm advantages working out quite well as Ryu dodges away from the Chum. The Waters dodges right back in. Betsy gonna take the fight right to him, but he's locked up by the chains. Ignite burning Ryu's health bar away, and his passive goes as he flashes immediately. Meanwhile, a tower's taken up top.
Yeah, he was afraid of Betsy flashing offensively, putting some damage out that he couldn't flash out of anymore. Spec flash from Ryu, not quite sure if it was necessary. Oruana barely keeping that tower alive. Gambit looking for the cross map dragon. H2K pushing onwards, hoping that Cabbage Shard wave skill is not enough. He likely will have to use his ultimate on the top lane, I guess, to clear that, but that's fine because he's not needed in the bot lane. Yeah, double barrel clear. Stopping that push. Dragon for Gambit. Not too bad for Gambit. I think they're reasonably happy with this. Betsy won that trade, forced out the mid laner. A lot of people in the top lane. Gambit take up an objective. They're ready to swing that gold even closer. Yes, it's a 2.8k lead, but tower on the bot lane is at about 10 or 15%. Look at that tower, very low. Lulex, though, wants to punish potential greed that's coming.
But we're going to be able to see it, but they know Oduwamne's there. Given will be on his guard. He's got the BF sword now.
Might see
trade back. Smite's on him. They throw down the equalizer as well. Can he get back to his base fast enough? No. He goes down. Oduwamne picks up kill number three.
And look at how close Forgiving is to getting his flash back up. Good timing there from H2K. Kill him right before he has his flash. And snowballing that advantage even more. 0-2 on Forgiven right now. Not on the mobile champion, not on that Lucian, not on that Graves, and he values those gap closers so highly because he does so well with them. He can use them offensively, defensively, add more variables to his play, but he's very stagnant, very predictable in his Ashe play, and H2K is capitalizing on the glaring weakness that's in that Ashe, that is the fact that she's immobile. She has to spot the ganks with her double Hawkshot, which is global, as Kobe likes to track the jungler in his camps, but Gambit didn't do that, didn't find Lulex, found an opening. Found three openings so far. One flash burn, one return gank, and now another gank just right here.
Yep, so Betsy takes a little bit of damage there from Ryu. Oduwamne doing quite well. Chases Betsy away off that pink ward. Really Gambit wants to keep that one alive.
Gambit needs that bottom lane tower to get some gold. 13.7k against 17.7k. Running some quick mathematics there. That's 4,000 gold lead on H2K. 12 minutes in the game. Here's the arrow.
Enchanted Crystal Arrow is a flying, but it won't go anywhere except across the map. Lulex sees it whiz by. H2K still unperturbed by this. They're going to keep on pushing in the mid.
And that's what you want to see if you're H2K right now. If Gambit has to resort to desperation arrows, that means that the pressure is putting Gambit in an uncomfortable position. They don't have the wave clear here. Lulu mid lane could have cleared that. Not Lulu support though, however. And Betsy, with so many people there, he has to back off. Another tower goes down. H2K 3 towers to 0.
Yeah, they're doing fantastic controlling this game, but Gambit, they just don't really have an answer. Diamond Fox was hanging out in the brush, but he's spotted out by the timely Scrying Orb. So, another ward down now. H2K, they just keep pressing their advantage across the way. That tower on the bottom, as you mentioned, it still hasn't gone down, and Gambit can't safely take it.
Forgiven had to move from the bot lane to the mid lane, which leaves a very stacked wave that, again, Ryu can just clean in two distortions, immediately push that back, put back the pressure, where Gambit is slow in their wave clear, pushing it out slowly, step by step by step. H2K can reap the benefits from that time spent from Gambit, clean that wave immediately and push it out. They're moving Betsy to the side lane to become that split push fizz that we've seen before, but it might be a little bit too late. 0-0-0 on Betsy, and he'll need some solo kills right now on this lane if Gambit has any hopes of clawing back. But let's not forget, Rocket did it last game.
It's very true. But Ryu has been giving Betsy a bit of trouble. I would say, yes, he's even they've been able to trade out, but Ryu's not going to give him an opportunity to really push this wave. I feel like he's wasting time down there.
H2K realizing that tier 1 towers are down, Dragon is down, and they have no option to really siege on tier 2s. Instead of pushing this lane back, like I said earlier, they're denying more waves by slowly freezing it and then blowing it up right before it hits the tower, still keeping that tower alive. Betsy, again, this is what they call panic plays. That arrow from Forgiven earlier was similar to Betsy's ulti. Yeah, it might hit, but there's a very low chance, and if your enemy is prepared for a hit, you're just opening up for getting countered. Betsy now has no ultimate, so Gambit,
he's gonna have to make
making anything happen.
Really crazy, well, move around. Let's see if Ryu can intercept him here. Lulex, Urgent Strike from Betsy. He's trying to get into the brush. We'll talk about that.
This is where you want to get a cross-snap objective in mid. Betsy's keeping the missile. Two people, three people here. They want to get something in the mid lane. Can they get a tower, anything? No, H2K is there.
They're the ones on it right now.
Equalizer
Forgiven
goes down.
He's going to have to flash after the Equalizer. He's going down. So is Gosu Pepper. It's H2K that find themselves something across the map. Another kill for Odoamne. Not only that, one for Yarnin as well.
And we touched on it before. He picked up that farm in the bottom lane, then got Forgiven's flash, then got a kill, and H2K knows how to play with a carry top laner. Odoamne showing up big on his rumble. 4-0-1.
4-0-1 is that score. Now, down in the bottom, Ryu still giving Betsy a bit of a hard time. Lulex is there as well. So H2K taking stock of the situation. They've got themselves three towers with that outer in the middle going down. Betsy can hold the line here. They're not pushing it, but now it might change. Betsy, flash, or rather hook is predicted just a little bit. And Chum the Waters onto Lulex. Betsy's looking to finish a kill off here if he can. Wild Gross on him, Kasing. In comes the barrel as Kabushard picks up a kill. Diamond Prox, meanwhile, in the brush, duking it out with Yarnin. Betsy will find Ryu, and Gambit have gotten back into this one with a double kill now onto Kabushard.
That went about as wrong as it could for H2K, and I think a little bit overzealous by Kasing, wanting to show that he could predict Betsy's dodge pattern. Flashed in aggressively on that tower. Not quite sure why, but Gambit did a really good job capitalizing on that play. Barrel was good as well, and just three kills here, and they just got a little bit more breathing room. But even after getting three kills against Zero, they're still 4,000 gold behind. But this is actually what they want to look for. They want H2K to put their hand a little bit too deep in the cookie jar and then close it.
Yeah, instead it was H2K's fingers. They got closed on that cookie jar. Here comes Dragon. It's respawn here. Gambit, though, are waiting for Lulex. Diamond Prox chasing him down.
Yeah,
doesn't quite clear the Rek'Sai down below.
Rek'Sai is like a T-Rex. If you don't move, she might not see you. If you take one step, you're spotted out.
The Dragon, however, has not been started up just yet. Too many H2K members here. There's a teleport available for Odoamne, even though he's off up in the top lane. That's an advantage over on Kabushard. He can't afford, well, he can't really get involved if he goes up top.
And if there's one champion you do not want to start a Dragon contest or fight against, it is a 4-0 level 11 Rumble with a very Magic Pen focused build. He has the Soak Shoes. He has the Abyssal Scepter finished just now as well. He has so much magic resistance reduction and penetration, brother, and he will blow up carries. I don't think anybody on Gambit's side has even enough magic resistance to come up positive.
No, and that's a real problem here for Gambit right about now. So they're going to just back off, play it safe, give the Dragon over to HGK. That's only their first, so they do get that stat boost available to them to match Gambit's and, you know, hopefully make a little bit more use of it. Odoamne, though, he's having a field day on this Rumble 4-0. It's just a crazy score to start out, but this is the guy. I mean, he's Odoamne has the largest share of damage for a top laner on any team in the European LCS, and now we know why.
Yeah, I'm just quickly double checking. I think Odoamne is dealing true damage to every member on Gambit right now on Magic, and look at that Flame Spitter.
Yep, throws down the Equalizer, it's not going to connect, but Ryu says that's just fine. I'll clean it up. Grabs himself his first kill, and Diamond Prox is knocked away from it all.
When a Rumble at this point in the game is dealing true damage to you, you don't want to fight, but Gambit's only way back into this game is somehow getting a pick, getting somehow a fight, because all the pressure is on H2K's side right now.
Gambit will look to try and reverse that, but all starts with maybe getting a pick. Diamond Prox just can't catch the Rek'Sai.
Well, she just tunnels out every time.
Gambit still trying to catch this tier 2.
Arrow prompted and ready, but if it connects at any distance greater than a screen, it gives H2K enough time to poise and get ready for the fight that they're inevitably going to win anyways. If it connects any slower, the stun is not going to be that high, so a bit of a catch 22 here for Forgiven. Really hard to use that arrow. In the worst case, Kassim can even take it and get Fate called out and just survive it that way. H2K looking to roam between the lanes. They don't want to give an even fight against Gambit. Just uneven numbers, make a pick in the rotation.
Let's take stock where the game's at, though, because we're approaching the 20-minute mark in about a minute and 15. Then Baron will become available, but H2K, they still got this solid lead. Kassim still trying to scare him out with the Lantern toss out. Looking at the 280 carries, because this was, you know, we did see the lane swap from H2K, but I don't think it was for fear of Ashe this time around. Forgiven, 031, he's not really been extremely effective on this Ashe. He's been able to wave clear, and that's about it, to be honest.
I'm not quite sure what prompted it. Could have been a predictive lane swap as well. Ashe Lulu is a very poke-heavy lane, but Hjarnan and Kassim are not afraid to 2v2. They came out with some bold statements as well, thinking they were amongst, if not the best, bot lane in the scene right now. Haven't really had the opportunity to show that too much. Forgiven obviously wasn't afraid to play that 2v2 because he went down bottom with Gosu Pepper, but lanes didn't happen. H2K macro, a very strong macro level team, has a really good 10 to 20 minute spike into the game with a lot of objectives. Not quite this game because they took all their objectives before 10 minutes.
Yeah, and Gambit on the other side, I feel like, is a team that's still struggling to kind of find its new identity with Forgiven. You can't afford to make these mistakes and give up these objectives to a team like H2K, because even if they, you know, arguably underperformed, well, they definitely underperformed last week, they will not so easily give those kinds of things up. And Gambit is finding that out the hard way.
Yeah, I'm still so curious why Gambit decided to change up their draft. They had the makings of a good draft. They had the Lulu into the LeBlanc matchup in the mid lane, decided to switch it to support. They had the Gragas jungle, decided to switch it to top. They didn't have the Volibear, which I would have liked to see kept that way. Picked it up anyways, went for the mid, and it's not working.
No, it's certainly not. 0-1, he's really not been involved in much. Equalizer thrown down, and Gosu Pepper forces the flash away from him. Fate's call, Kassim. The slingshot doesn't connect on the hook. In comes the arrow. It's going to ping Lulex in the back of the head, but can't really get there in time to do anything. Another tunnel from the Rek'Sai and a Prey Seeker parting shot. It'll mean that Gambit gets nothing off of it.
Hey, Gambit playing so passive that H2K has a hard time finding an opening. Getting a little bored.
He's going to burn his flash to get away from the Chum of the Waters, and then comes up again.
Good.
A Mimic Distort.
Gambit's doing what they can here, honestly. H2K is not snowballing their objective. At this point, you do not want to trade your Equalizer for support flash. As juicy and as inviting the opportunity may look to equalize the support in the jungle, if you have an idea that he might have his flash up, it's not worth it. Because it costs you the tempo. You can use that Equalizer to set up for a potential dive, because you have enough damage to pull it off. On his back, no ultimate this time.
Gambit's going in. Diamond was able to get the flash and the knock up. They will shut down Odoamne, some much needed gold over to Kabu Shard. So Gambit grabs a little bit back for themselves.
H2K looks like a team that's not used to playing with this lead right now. They're a little flustered. They want to snowball it, but they don't even know how. Odoamne is in the enemy jungle alone, getting picked off, not respecting any wards. You could call it bold. I think it's overzealous. 4v5 right now. Looking for hooks, Ryu's looking for a flank. And this is not the calculated H2K that we've seen before. A little bold.
A little bit, indeed. Maybe a little bit panicked as well, as Gambit are forced to back away. Now in comes Ryu.
The teleport is up.
Yep, looks like he might have missed that combo, but Lulex won't. There we go. They managed to get that one, but Big Earth comes out to make Lulex turn back. Diamond Prox now healed up, but he's going down to Yharn, and they've caught Cabo Shard on the line. The Fat Man makes a big target as Odawamne is picked off. We've got another double kill coming in for Yharn, and Betsy will take down Odawamne, and that's a triple kill. Betsy and Gosu Pepper limp away.
Yeah, Kalista was nerfed a while ago in her defensive hops. But Yharn doesn't need them. He keeps hopping forward, and they're still exactly the same. Gets up a triple kill right there. Odawamne, again, a little audacious flash, flashing in tower range, getting turned immediately anti-seed, but it was enough to buy time for Yharn to get going. Blade of the Ruined King and Renounce Hurricane finished already. Whole heap of damage.
Whole heap of damage, yes, indeed.
Let's that again.
Take
a little
look at
slower.
That.
So things to watch out for this fight is Lulex double knockup that's about to come in here. Ryu misses chains, but it's zoning chains. Either they hit or people are forced to walk into Lulex. Double knockup, good. I want to keep my eyes on the Yharn here, rather, see what he does. Closing to Sing. Good play on Diamond Prox coming in right about now. Finishes that up, gets the reset. Odawamne is buying time. You can see Seed by the arrow. The Sing finishes up the passive on Kalista. Even if your support gets the kill, you can still get the credit on Kalista if she has the W passive. Meanwhile, Dragon goes down for Gambit in return. Just want to stress on that point one more time. If you have a support that's always stealing your kills, try to play some Kalista. She applies that passive, and then the support supplies the other half, so to say, romantically speaking. Then the 12% maximum HP damage comes in, and the kill credit goes to Kalista. That's what happened right there. Triple kill for...
Big matchup.
Yeah, perfect matchup. Really good synergy in that matchup.
Have liked Yharn and Kasing's performance this game in particular. And, you know, again, HK, as we said, not without the mistakes. They maybe are changing it up a little bit on the fly. It was talked about. I mean, you know, Trevor said on PTL they need to think outside the box a little bit. They need to vary up a little bit. But right now, they're doing a lot of things right. Gambit can't really react to too much, but they are pinging on the Baron. It's not going down fast enough. Gambit Gaming should be able to scare him away here, and they do.
Ryu's a bit out of mana. Pulls it on Cabo Shard. He's mobile. They're going to throw in Kasing. I heard the Fates call. Yep, there it is. They're throwing him in.
They have found him. Explosive cast, but the hook will pull him. The box will keep him. And Yharn should be able to take him down. Yep, that's kill number 5.
Yeah, definitely heard that Fates call come out. I think Gambit too, but it was too late to back up. They're in the middle lane. Arrow coming in.
And flying off into the distance.
Yeah, pretty much. 0-4-3 Unforgiven. Not quite has the hit rate on the arrows that he would like, so tough game for him. And he is one of the prime carries on the Gambit lineup.
Uh-oh.
Ryu going for Fog. Oh my god.
Elizer is one way to put it. Goodbye, Gosu Pepper. Baron is the next target in H2K's sights, but is this a little bit too bold? Forgiven, Betsy and Diamond Prox are still here. The bear is caught. They peel off the Baron. The bear's going down. Earth comes up, but Odawamne is still kicking, and H2K are right back on it here. Can Betsy and Forgiven stop this Baron? No, they're not even going to try. Just watching from the sidelines as Odawamne nearly gets taken down, stays alive, and they back with the prize.
And we've said this before, but we haven't stressed it. This game, Kalista is an incredibly potent pick when it comes to securing objectives. Even if your smite is down, the Ren stacks are enough. Goes up to 1,500 damage later in the game, and that's enough to secure any Baron, so you can comfortably do it. And that's why HK was so liberal with their Baron right there. They didn't care that Gambit was around. If they came too close, they would turn around. Good hook by Kasing, nice opening, turn back to the Baron. They're tanky enough, have enough sustain, or sustained damage rather, to keep doing that Baron. And yeah, putting some nails ready to get them in the coffin. Not quite yet. 8,000 gold. Observer's having a little fun tracking Rek'Sai.
So now H2K, what do they do with this Baron buff? They look to maybe pick off Diamond Prox. Ryu goes forward. Kasing still there, holding onto his hook. The flip up. Diamond knows his days are numbered. And Ryu just takes him down. Man, I am loving that he's gone back to playing these assassins.
Kasing is in his comfort zone. If you didn't see it, what he did there is to put the lantern. Once Ryu clicked it, he flashed forward to give Ryu another gap closer, but he adds another hook.
Yep. Oh, chum the waters. It's not going to matter too much as Ryu just kites around a bit, and Betsy gets taken down by Yharnam. Flash over the wall. H2K are on a roll. Ryu is looking confident here as he picks up another kill. Forgiven now is the last man standing. Ryu throws down the Zhonya's. Forgiven has to back to the safety of his fountain. The inhibitor is all gone at 27 minutes into the game. H2K extend the lead again.
Kasing is such a fun player to watch once he's in his comfort zone. He's not afraid to make those plays. Earlier he flashed in, gave Gambit pretty much the opportunity to take a triple kill, 3-0 trade there in the bot lane, but that doesn't faze him. Yes, he might fail sometimes, but he's not afraid to make these plays, and that's why he's one of the best supports in Europe right now. Has that aggressive Lantern flash for Ryu. Lantern on the hook, goes in. Bold plays, but it's working because they're in the lead and it gives him the liberty to get a little more creative. Ryu going on Forgiven here. Chains don't quite connect.
Still does half his health and damage. Forgiven doesn't really flinch, but that doesn't matter when you're close to getting taken down. Ryu is going to have to get out of there soon, but he'll have an empowered recall to get himself nice and safe. Pings on the bottom side for Odawamne as he pushes the wave. A lot of Gambit members collapsing on it, but he's staying within safety range.
What does this mean for H2K right now? They're about to go 2-2, keeping their placement streams alive. If they win this game, let's assume they do. 2-2, fantastic score, but Gambit 0-3 right now, and that's gonna get tricky.
Yeah, that
2-1 rather.
Indeed. Yeah,
they were 1-1 first week. My math is bad.
One thing
bad.
I've learned is never do math on a cast.
Never do math in a cast, because if it's right, people won't mind. But if it's wrong,
you'll never live it down. Of course. H2K. Continue to push in the top side. Not much Gambit can do about this as Ryu zones Diamond procs and Forgiven away. Looks like they might be setting up for the coup de grace. Gambit Gaming on the defensive yet again. Dragon's a minute away. Should we have options?
So yeah, Cavishard has his explosive cast to stop that teleport from Odawamne, but looks like he's not teleporting to the team. The team is moving in for him. It's lost tier 3 tower. This is why you usually don't defend him.
Yep, he's gonna burn his flash. Body slam into Odawamne. Lulek's taking the tower. There's the explosive cast, but it won't matter. Kabushard is knocked up. Kabushard is taken down. And H2K, where they can't succeed on the top, they move down bottom, and nothing Gambit can do can stop them.
And Gambit is getting stuck in these positions where no amount of outplay is possible. Once that fight starts, there's a 0.1 chance for Kabushard to survive that, and it would require monumental screw-ups on HTK's side, and that speaks to HTK being so good as a macro side. They're laying down the equalizer, bit of a zoning equalizer. They could take the tower, but they want the kills. They're bloodthirsty.
Yes, they are, so they will first get that one turret. Diamond Prox has to head back to base, but they've not got much time in left in this game. Gambit, here comes the Crystal Arrow. It hits Yharnam. He should be able to kite back if he wants to. Ryu, though, is in the middle. He pops his clone, or he gets his clone popped, I should say, as Lulex gets a massive knockup and a triple kill again. Going over to Yharnam. That
quadra
is going to be
yet
a quadra kill. The Nexus turrets melting after all of that. The pressure was just too much. And H2K are knocking on the door. 30 minutes into the game, they have managed to take down Gambit Gaming and open their split at 2-1.
Yeah, very convincing win here by H2K and Gambit. Yeah, 0-3 at the start of the European Spring Split. Being on a place you want to be in. We've seen teams come back to this before. Lowens have started split 0-4 and came back. But
what else can you say, though? H2K, they seemed a little off their game last week. They still came out 1-1. Over this Gambit team, though, they made few mistakes, capitalized on whatever they could get, and basically just rolled over Gambit.
Yeah, and that man right there, he was happy. Odawamne, what a stellar performance on his Rumble. He said it before in an interview, he used to play a lot of tanks, defensive. He was the rock his team needed to rely on, but yeah, they trusted him enough to open up his champion pool. Mm-hmm. He bought the Rumble, not the first time. He did well so far in pretty much every game I can recall. And yeah, at one point, I can't stress this enough. He had the Sorg Shoes, the Abyssal Scepter, and the Haunting Guys. That's roughly, if I do the math correctly, and I think I do, that's 50 magic pen slash reduction if you're fighting. So you reduce 50 magic resistance of your opponent. I checked it in game. At that point, none of the Gambit members had over 50 magic resistance, which means essentially Odawamne was level 11 and dealing 2 damage on the Rumble. That's a lot of damage. And we saw how that snowballed later in the game as he was First, he popped his equalizer and Ghost of Pepper managed to flash out. Later, he didn't even have the chance to flash anymore. Immediately roasted on that barbecue and stellar performance. And Lulex as well gets that Rek'Sai. We saw it last week as well. He doesn't want Gragas. He wanted Rek'Sai over Gragas. Got it this draft anyways. And we saw why Rek'Sai, she was banned so often.
Yeah. And, you know, this was a much marked improvement over his Evelynn performance.
Yes.
I mean, that was just back to the Lulex I think everyone expected, back to the Lulex that we know. So everyone on H2K did their job exactly the way they needed. I was really, really impressed also with the bottom lane, the Kalista Thresh combo. You mentioned that fun combo interaction. It worked out really, really well where they were just slingshotting. Kasing didn't land every single hook, but he didn't nearly need to.
He landed enough.
He landed exactly
enough. More than I did.
There you go.
But yeah, that's good interaction. And with Kalista, you obviously want that ranged component in your support, bringing out the passive of the Sentinel. The W, 12% of your maximum health damage is good to take down these tanks. So you need a tag team, kind of. Kalista can't tear through these tanks alone. Although at the end of the game, Hjarnen could. We saw the power of the Renounce coming in. If you can snowball, he was hitting three people at once. Killing one, get the reset, slowing all the others. Killing another one, reset, slowing all the others. Killing another one, reset, quadra kill to finish out that game. And fantastic performance by the H2K roster combined. Probably will be proud.
Mm-hmm. By their powers combined, H2K come out with that win. And for more on it, we're going to send it over to the analyst desk to break.